I apologize, I am late. I was stuck in e-voting discussions. I did not spend my break on my WhatsApp account because apparently there is a man in the middle. And I find that spooky. And we learn a lot about the man in the middle by our next speaker. The stage is yours.
Can you all hear me? Yeah, that's fine. Okay, so because the topic is trust, let's discuss about maybe the trust you put in secure messenger, meaning, for example, Signal, Telegram, WhatsApp, and see that how you may get tricked by spear phishing because of them. So a few words about me. Used to be a developer. I've been working last 12 years in the French-speaking part of Switzerland, basically coding and then designing security product and solution. Strong focus on mobile for last 8 years. Now, software security consultant at my own company, so I can say whatever I want. This is convenient. No internal com service or whatever. No issue for the recording. Okay, so basically, I help companies building security in their software, mobile, and also because we are discussing about trust, so lots of topic around blockchain and all that, where you don't get trust just by magic. Okay, so well, everyone is aware that now all the big messaging apps, they switched to end-to-end encryption in the last 2 years. So that's really good because it means that privacy has become a requirement. And if we step back 5 years ago, I wouldn't have bet on, okay, everything is going to be fully end-to-end encrypted everywhere because people told you it's going to be really terrible from a performance point of view for backend, and it's going to drain the battery of mobile device and all that. But yeah, within 1 year or two, everyone switched to it, so that's really good. And there are a lot of communication around it, to a point where even government started to complain and say, hey, come on, this is somehow used by terrorists, and we can't spy on our citizens anymore, and we somehow we need backdoors to keep you safe. So, and because of that, well, maybe you get the perception that those applications are totally unbreakable. Because even if CIA is asking for backdoors, somehow it means that they cannot break them. And because of that, and you tell me after if I'm wrong, but I see it that in companies, really, those secure messengers, they are really starting to get used as the secure channel. Let's say you need to share a temporary password. Of course, you don't want to do it by email, by SMS, it's not that convenient. Yeah. You say, yeah, I use Signal, I use WhatsApp. Even with some customers, they have to share pen test reports. Of course, they're encrypted, zip encrypted or PDF encrypted, and they need to send you the password, and Signal is really convenient for them. Also, yeah, when I need to share diagrams, really sensitive architecture topic and all that, just send it with WhatsApp, it's encrypted, that's fine. And even some that are really scared doing a conversation by phone and say, hey, just call me via WhatsApp, it's end-to-end encrypted, even the voice, so it should be better. And it's also used, and we see why it's important, as a fast priority channel. You know, with all those emails, notifications, and all that, people get lost. Whereas with those secure messengers, hey, I have something in WhatsApp, yeah, I will read it and process it in priority. And something you should have seen is somehow you don't have spam. So that's why it's really convenient. And not like email. There you see, OK, I only get message from people somehow I know, and I don't get ads and all that on it. So it's really convenient, and it feels super secure. OK, if we have a quick look at the crypto, it looks super, super good. So this is the advanced fact-checking in Signal protocol. I won't go in detail. If there was an obvious flaw, it would have been found much before. But when I started playing with them, I was just, okay, so they do really, really good crypto. But really, the installation and provisioning process is super simple. You don't have to do anything. Basically, you just get a SMS code. You type in 6 digits, and then that's it. And all by magic, you get all this crypto stuff working. And somehow you don't know how it's linked either to your device or your phone number. That's unclear to the end user. So it's good for convenience, but you don't really know how it works. And somehow you get all the people you know added by magic. It reads the address book and it knows that, okay, your friend already has this application and it adds it automatically. So it looks super convenient, but this provisioning and handling of contacts doesn't seem that complex as a crypto behind. So yeah, I say, yeah, let's dig further. So first thing you have to know, in the mobile world, yeah, it's super easy to read, modify, create contacts. There is an API for that. So here you have an example for Android. Yeah, well, you have Java code for that, and you have documentation for that. Well, documentation is real crap, but you have it. And what you need in practice when you deploy that, so basically you just have to ask for permission, let's say this one for Android, read and write contacts. And then as long as the user has approved that, either at installation time or at first runtime, then it works. And then with this API, you can do whatever you want with the address book. So for me, there was clearly room for a side channel attack. What's really important, and I will insist, and you will see later on why it's really important, it doesn't require a rooted device. It's there, the API works as long as you accept the permission and that's it. And I say, okay, let's try something I will call man in the contacts. So let's see what happens if I start playing with the contacts. So to make it quick, I just made simple screenshots of WhatsApp, Signal, Telegram, and what I do, I say, okay, suppose you have Alice, which is a legitimate contact, and then I create another contact, which is called Whitespace Alice. See what happens? This is the real Alice. This is the name, and this is Whitespace Alice. Behind its sieve, you don't see the difference, and in the conversation history, you can't see any difference because somehow they decided to trim the white space. So just from there, guessing who is the real one starts to get tough. Telegram, exactly the same thing. Signal, same stuff, but you can do screenshots for Android. They say it's kind of security measures, but they don't do it for iPhone. So it just does not make any sense, but same trick is working. Okay, so it seems really so simple, and yet when you see that, you say, okay, maybe it gets easy to trick people with that, and why something that simple work? You see all the crypto, and they have designed it well and all that. So for me, first, there's a design error from a security point of view. So somehow they use a phone number as an implicit identifier. So you don't have user IDs and all that. They say, okay, I use the phone number and then that's it. And everything is hidden from the user. On top of that, then they use the contact name. But you don't have control on top of that. And you hardly know many phone numbers. So that's, let's say, a bit clumsy from a design point of view. But something far wrong is they do what they say, what they call TOFU, trust on first use. You know, when you connect with SSH on the server, you get this pop-up that say, hey, here's the key the first time you have to trust it. So this is annoying, and most of the time you don't read it and all that. So they say, yeah, for user convenience, we won't do that. So the first time you exchange with a new contact, there is an exchange of keys, and this key is automatically generated and trusted the first time. And only the next messages, the software is going to check that the same key is being used. So basically, new contact equals new key. And then last thing, why it works? Yeah, well, you know, maybe 10 years ago, people start registering domain names with special characters and Cyrillic and Whitespace and all that. And people got phished because of that before SSL certificate suppliers started to control a little more what's the acceptable characters. So again, well, use the same old trick and it's working. You see, this is just a white space. But you imagine with Unicode and all that, you have really, really, really many possibilities to have a username that looks like a legitimate one. So if they decide to do something else with a white space, you just go back to the hacking literature that's 10 years old and then you get workaround for that. And last point, which is really why it's working and why they mess up. They don't include the end user and the mobile in their threat model. We'll see why. So what they do, they really focus on protecting the network because they know that NSA would be listening. and they want to protect the backend. So basically, they want that if NSA comes down and say, okay, we want the logs, we want your servers because there is terrorist or blah, blah, whatever, they can give them the servers and they won't give anything about the communication and end users because everything has been done and encrypted and only meta information has been kept and all that. So really their threat model is more we protect from government agencies. But we don't put the end user and the mobile application in the loop. So for them, clearly, social engineering is too cheap, it's too easy, it's too obvious that they put it implicitly out of scope. But what's interesting, I made a first demo 2 years ago at DEF CON Crypto Village, and 2 months after, there's an academic paper that was published, which is called Formal Security Analysis of the Signal Protocol. You can read it there if you want, and there's something that's really important, hidden in like 40 pages of maths and boring stuff, which says, signal specifies, when we say signal here, it's signal protocol, it's not a signal app. Signal specify a mandatory method for participants to verify each other's identity keys through an out-of-band channel. But most implementations do not require such verification to take place before messaging can occur. So by design, you need to exchange key with an out-of-band channel, which is not implemented at all. So somehow you have a formal proof that it's secure, but in practice you cannot implement it or you don't want to implement it because you haven't found a way to make it convenient for users. So basically you have this paper that says that it's super safe, but it's based on an assumption that's not implemented in real life. It's annoying, huh? So I do a quick threat model here for me because I like to do that to find big security issues in design. And this time I will focus on mobile. So what you have here, you have okay the backend, messaging backend. You have something that has already been exploited. The first time they send you an init code via SMS. So this is not good from a security point of view. Maybe you heard what Google said this morning about that. There has been proven attacks in Iran when they intercepted the SMS init code. And then after, of course, you're lost because someone already has the init code and can register another device with your identity. What they do really well is encrypting those messages on the network and backend part. Backups are, let's say, so-so, but I don't really care now for that. There are papers that show that, yeah, with backups, they leak information. I focus on mobile, and I want to insist that today, mobile OS are really the most secure OS that exists because they have really strong sandboxing features. So basically, if you have the messaging app and then another application, let's say a game, they don't see the same. They can't see the network data of each other. They can't see the storage of each other. So it's really well sandboxed, but with this API, they have a shared access to contacts. And this has been totally forgotten when they designed the mobile application of those secure messengers. So what can we do with that? Well, I showed 2 years ago how you can do a man in the middle with that. So in principle, it's rather easy. So let's say Alice wants to talk to Bob, but Alice was tricked into installing another application that created fake contacts. So with that, Alice thinks she's talking to Bob, but in fact, she's talking to Whitespace Bob. Then Eve gets this message and forwards it to the real Bob. And Eve has also created a fake Whitespace Alice in Bob's contact. And then with that, you get a full man in the middle. So really, Alice is talking to Bob, but via an attacker as a proxy. And you don't really see what happens. You see just after the answers from the vendors. And because they didn't really care, we made a demonstration a few months ago in London with a student that implemented it. So at AppSec.eu, what we did, we say, okay, we have another use case, let's talk about spear phishing, because you say, yeah, maybe you already use it in your companies to exchange secure data. So what we did, we implemented a small stupid game, which requires access to contacts, rock, paper, scissors, social version of it. You can download it from the Play Store. It's wrong here. It's been published 1 year ago. And of course, when you publish it and you update it, you don't have any issue. It's not a malware. It doesn't require your root permission. It's just a standard game that wants to read and write your contact because it wants to search for friends so that you can play rock, paper, scissors with them. So it seems totally legitimate. You have the source code there. Help yourself. We implemented also a command and control server. And then with that, you have a nice web interface, GitHub here, where you can send a malicious link to any poor user that has installed this super cool game. So with that, basically, with the command and control server, you see of all your victims, you see all the contacts, and you can create fake contacts and then decide to send links or whatever. So before contacting the vendors, I was there. I say, OK, you know, in the newspaper, you often see things people discuss about WhatsApp and Telegram, and they find a big bug and whatever, and it's never clear if it's exploitable and what's the real impact. So before contacting them, I say, OK, let's do simple risk assessment, because what's important in the rest is there a big risk? So I use a really simple assessment framework where I say that basically the risk is the easiness of the attack times the user impact. So, and for the easiness slash difficulty of the attack, I put two things. I say, okay, to be successful in my attack, somehow I need technical skills and I need logistics skills. So basically, I need to know how to do stuff and I need money to do it or time. So technically, well, implementing that is easy. You have the API for that. The only issue is having up-to-date documentation, that's it. And as you saw, the application is published, you can check it. You will never have any issue having it published and approved. From a logistic point of view, yeah, if you want to do a massive attack, it can cost you a bit more money. In practice, one phone number is enough. So that's cheap. You just buy a SIM card for $10 and then you can start tricking users. But somehow you need to make a fuss around your stupid game so that people start installing your game. So if you want a massive attack, somehow, yeah, you need to spend money or do whatever you can to have people installing it. But as you have access to their contact information, it's rather easy as soon as user A has installed it to send a message to all the users, say, hey, do you want to play rock, paper, scissors with me? And then hoping to have a viral effect. User impact, well, for me, it's high because you can target, you can spy, you can trick thousands of users. And the only use case for those secure messengers is to communicate securely. So if it's not the case, then yeah, of course, it's really big impact because the feature just doesn't work. So when you do that, you arrive at something that's between high and very high. So I say for that, yeah, sure, I should contact the vendors and I will show them the slide and then we discuss if they agree or not. The hunt began. Telegram. Of course, they have no bug bounty or responsible disclosure policy and all that. They have some null mailbox, never got answered. Even if you tweet, you say you are DEFCON or whatever, they never answered. So first takeaway, forget Telegram, really. WhatsApp, aka Facebook. So yeah, so you can submit, there is responsible disclosure. You have to push them a little so that they process your ticket. And then they say, yeah, well, ultimately, if you have malware, you lose. Well, I'm not talking about malware. That's where the controversy starts, you see? It doesn't have to be rooted. This rock, paper, scissors game, for me, it's not a malware, because it's a legitimate game. It's just exfiltrating some data, but it has the authorization to do so. And then what they say, well, the original conversation remained bound to the original phone number, so we don't plan to make any change. Well, we don't care. We are not sending a message to the wrong user, so it's somehow a bit confusing, but let us know. I'll let them know, they never answered back. Then Signal, which was for me the most important because it's the same protocol under the hood. So again, I had to fight and tweet and all that to get some answer. But then I got small discussion with Moxie Marlinspike that designed the protocol. First time he answers me okay, well, we have safety numbers, and users will see the difference and it's gonna work. So basically, he didn't read my report saying that the issue is when you have a new contact for the first message, when you start, this is a tofu issue, blah, 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 okay. And I answer him several times, push him again to get an answer, and then he says, yeah, well, Signal is not an antivirus. Good luck, bye-bye. Over. So he was really disappointed there, but that was it. So that's why I talk about it and all that, but they don't plan to make any change and they did not make any change. Okay, so now what can you do? How do you live with that? If you believe it's a real issue. So first, yeah, you could either hope that while the mobile OS improves that, so sometimes I had tough discussions, I'd say, okay, it's not the fault of the secure messenger because somehow there's something broken in the sandboxing of the mobile OS. So somehow, if they also sandbox the contact information, then the attack doesn't work anymore and then that's over. Or at least, if they are stricter on the right operation to the address book. And it's most of, yeah, people think that, but if they try to sandbox that, yeah, just many applications don't work anymore. And why? Well, because WhatsApp, Signal, and all that, they won't be working well if they don't have enough access to those address book. Something you have to know, and that's why the at AppSec.eu we made the demo, and it really works well. When you install Signal and Telegram and all that, they add their own information in the address book. So because of that, from a game that should not be able to know what are the other applications installed, I know for sure if you have Signal and Telegram, because they create their own ID in the address book, so they use it. So really today, if you had sandboxing there, those messaging apps won't work anymore. Okay, so let's suppose they have something better. I think it's gonna take years before they have something that works decently and doesn't break everything. Secure messengers, well, for me it seems obvious. They are selling trust, they are selling safety, and you use those secure messengers because they are secure. Otherwise, you just use email or SMS or internal chat of Facebook or whatever. So somehow, it should be their concern. You see all the crypto they did? Just because they don't trust the network, they are afraid of NSA that comes and steals the backend and all that. So because of that, they decided to do really, really good work to protect it. But then why they wouldn't also protect from this, let's say, mobile missing feature? So there is one solution that would be easy but terrible for user convenience. Well, you forget the automatic handling of contacts. You do it the old way, like you remember Skype 10 years ago. When you wanted to talk to someone, you had to add it manually. You had to add his email address, and somehow you controlled your contacts. You know who you added in your address book. They were not there present automatically there. If you're a secure messenger, maybe it would make more sense to be sure that only those people can talk to you. Because I said at the beginning, you don't have spam, but how it works in practice, it just says because you have a contact in your phone number, the secure messengers consider that it's someone you trust and that it's someone that is authorized to talk to you. So behind this choice of implicit adding of all the contacts, you have a really, really, really strong trust decision there. That says if someone in the contact, it's trusted, it's not spam, I should display it to the end users. So really for me, the assumption they put there on the contact is really, really, really heavy, and you have to make sure that you can trust the information in the contact if you build trust on that. Another thing they could do, something I discussed with other providers like Wire, and they say, yeah, it's a good idea, just do that. Well, from what I show, the biggest concern is really at the first time. So when you start a new conversation with a new contact, this should be really rare because you don't have new contacts and new conversations every day. So just raise a warning flag that say, hey, be careful, this is the first time you ever talk to this contact. Maybe you should check it. And then just with that, I think it's like maybe half an hour development on their side for the mobile app. Nothing to change on the backend, and then you make users aware, and then that's it. Then on your side, if you're using that at your company, what can you do if you don't want to wait for fixes that will maybe never come? So either, let's say you have corporate devices and you control them and you can impose whatever you want to your employees. So something easy, I say, okay, you just whitelist applications that can be installed. And then with that, if you cannot install this rock, paper, scissors game, well, of course, nobody is going to tamper with your contacts if you just have proven applications that are safe, not convenient for users. Something else, but I didn't get a clear answer from the MDM vendors. See if it's possible that they somehow they always push your corporate directory inside the contacts and resync it often and often and often so that your employees only have contact information from the other employees and anything else is wiped and all that. So that, while the attack cannot be implemented in practice. But again, really, really, really killing user convenience. But for many companies, yeah, you still have personal device, or at least you have MDM, but let's say not fully enforced, and people can use it for personal use. And for that, well, the only thing I can advise now is, yeah, you have to train users that if they start a new conversation, they should be really careful. And there is something that I really dislike in WhatsApp. When this situation happens, you get a yellow message that says, hey, you are starting an end-to-end encrypted session, which makes the user think that, yeah, that's cool, I'm super safe, because WhatsApp tell me everything is encrypted now. Whereas it should say, hey, well, you should rather be careful, you are discussing with someone you never chatted before. So yeah, if you just can tell people to be careful in this solution. I'm not selling application there, but if you really want something more robust there, yeah, why not have a look at Streamer? Not because it's Swiss German, but first, the contact sync is optional. You can still handle your contacts manually and add them, and you don't even need phone numbers. You can do it just with pseudos and all that. And there's something that's really convenient from a user perspective. You have a trust level. By default, your contact is orange. It means somehow you can a little trust it or not. Red, when the key is not matching, and green, when you have explicitly through out of bound approved the key. So either you know you can show the QR code to your friend and you both scan it and then you have exchanged the keys with an out of bound channel and then the application knows it. And then from there you get green and you know that everything is under control. But what really impressed me, all the other big vendors, I had to push them 3-4 times, tell them I was talking at Las Vegas about it to get some partial answers there. I just send it to press at streamer.ch, and then the next day I had really clear design decision from the engineer and explaining me why they did so. So really, from a trust perspective, really brings confidence here. So to finish, yeah, so yeah, first message is, yeah, end-to-end encryption is great, but it cannot bring trust if you are not sure where you're talking to. They have those secure messengers, they have a really great reputation behind them, but they can be used against your organization. And I know, I discussed with ex-colleagues that are working in pen testing companies, and for them, such attack is really, really efficient when they are doing internal pen tests. Because when the CISO receives something from the CFO on his mobile coming through WhatsApp, he will highly likely click on it. Of course, you saw that the security model around contacts is really, really, really far too open for sensitive apps. So it means that if you have to do sensitive work with those contact information, you must be sure that you control what's inside your address book. And then last one, it's really, yeah, really be careful in the way you use those secure messengers. Have a look sometimes at the conversation history, and really something habits you should change is, you know, you get those push notifications and you just click on them and you can answer directly and all that. No, I really recommend that you just open the app and you see what was happening before. Why? Because, yeah, well, you will see the full history. And this last point that is really important also, and So I talk about internal pen tests. So people can send you links via those secure messenger. That's cool. But you have to be really careful because by design, all the servers and even the applications, they don't see or they are not allowed to see the content of the messages. Because on the back end, well, everything is encrypted, so they don't have a clue if there is a malicious link in it, a phishing website or whatever. And then on the mobile app, they could see that it's a malicious URL, but because they promise that they don't look, they keep your privacy, they don't look at the content of your message, they cannot do any filtering. So it's super easy to send a malicious link via those secure messengers because by design, they cannot filter them. So be very careful if you have a link coming from someone that seems to be close to you or top management and all that, please check the history. And if you have any question.
I'm sure there are questions in the room. I mean, this was a speech making me really feel better. I remember a really high-ranking security officer at the real big Swiss bank who once said, you know, BYOD actually stands for bring your own disaster. And this is just another chapter. Probably this joke is ages old, but it's just the next chapter of bring your own problem to your company. So are there any questions or is it all clear? You go back to your jobs and change everything as far as secure messengers are concerned. Well, thank you very much. Apparently everything is really clear.